grab your Bibles and go with me to Ezekiel 34. We're going to spend some time on this chapter here today, Ezekiel 34. And I want to talk to you tonight about cultivating a healthy and a perfect church. So grab your Bibles and grab your writing material and just get ready for some things that I believe God wants to talk to us here today. And by the way, how is everybody doing? Did you all have a great week? Yes? I want you to pray with me for a moment, because you all know that our church, you know, that we always enjoy the open heavens and the atmosphere being so, you know, dynamic. But I think in our service today, in our worship, maybe people are a little bit tired. But I just want nothing to interfere and to hinder the Word of God coming to you. Is that okay? So let's just bow for just a minute or two and just pray that God will cause a breakthrough in our service here today. Father, let's pray together. Father, we thank you and we bless you, Lord. Come, Holy Spirit, and speak to us. We truly want to hear your word. We don't want to hear the word of man, but the word of God. And Father, we thank you. Lord, we just come against anything that may have tried to hinder, Lord, our service. We take charge of these things and we break them in Jesus' name. Free the minds of your people and free our hearts, Father. Free our spirits, O God, in Jesus' name. Lord, let us be subdued by the power of your spirit. Let us be subdued by the power of your word, God. Lord, let nothing here, Lord, exalt itself against the knowledge of your word and the knowledge of you, Father. We thank you and we bless you, Father, in the name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen and amen. All right, Ezekiel 34, we're going to talk about cultivating a healthy and a perfect church. But before we read the scriptures, I just want to say, just on the onset of our message today, that there is no perfect church. Just in case you might be thinking like, well, I'm coming to breakthrough and I'm expecting people to be perfect and I'm disappointed. I just want to say to you that you'll never find a perfect church, because every church in the world will have its ups and downs, will have its issues. Just like a marriage will always have its ups and downs, marriage will always have its issues. Family will always have the good points and the bad points. They will have the negative and the positive. But what will create a healthy and a perfect church or marriage or family is people involved in it working deliberately to build. That's why I use the word cultivate, because if we really want to have a perfect church, we need to work together. We need to cultivate. We need to come with the hearts of, let's make this thing perfect, because the church of Jesus belongs to the imperfect people. In fact, Jesus said it like this, that he comes not for the healthy, but for the sick. He comes not for the righteous, but for those that are sinners. And the house of God should be a house full of imperfect people, sick people, spiritually, mentally, emotionally, whatever. It is okay to feel like you're not okay, because that's why we come to church for. And it doesn't make you weak. In fact, it makes you strong. Because a person that is honest about the condition of his life is a strong person. Those that are hiding behind the rich and the wealthy and the money and everything else and hide the real issues of life, I would say that those people are cowards. Because it takes a real man and a real woman to come out to the open and say, I need help. It takes a real person and a real man to come out and say, I need Jesus. It's an act of courage and strength when you and I break before God. I tell you this, the world may look at it as weak, but God sees us as commendable and courageous and powerful in the sight of God and in the sight of man. That's why it's important for us to understand that if we are going to have a strong, healthy, and a perfect church, we've got to work together. Now, that's why I have been talking about, the issues that have destroyed the children of Israel coming out of Egypt, crossing through the promised, the wilderness into the promised land, to stop the murmuring and the complaining, because these are the things that will weaken us. To stop the sexual immorality, because these are the things that will stumble us along the way. If we're going to eliminate these things and hear God and whatever God is saying to us, we are cultivating or working towards a healthy and a perfect church. Somebody say amen. So don't look at somebody addressing your sins as like people are judging you. No, God is just trying to make you strong. God is just trying to make your marriage strong. God is just trying to make the society that you're part of strong and healthy. That's why we have to eliminate some things in order for us to have a healthy and a very powerful, perfect church. That's why God talked to us about moving away from committing idolatry and testing God and tempting God. That's why we talk about Achan's sin, because one man's sin can bring a whole community into judgment. One man's sin can bring a whole family into judgment. It's important for us to understand that this Achan issue is a terrible thing if we don't deal with the Achan issues of our lives. I said something last week in which I'm going to be doing that more and more today, putting myself out there on the spotlight for you to judge, maybe criticize, but if you love me, you won't do that. Scrutinize if you have to, but I understand that as a pastor, I need to deal with my Achan issues, because if I don't deal with it, my one person's sin can bring judgment upon this whole house. I have seen a lot of churches crushed because men of God, as they preach and they teach behind the scene, they're up to other stuff that the church don't know. I have a wife that will tell you the truth, that I'm living okay right now. And I thank God that, you know, I'm accountable to her, and I'm accountable to the leaders of the church. I want you to do the same, to put yourself around people that you're accountable to so that they can speak into your life and keep you away from committing the Achan sin. We also talk about discipline. It's okay for God to discipline us. Remember, God's discipline is painful, but the fruits of it is powerful. Somebody say amen. Now, I said this in our last connect. I'd rather talk about the issues that hurt than talk about things that everybody's happy about. Because nobody really changed when you all talk about the things that everybody wants to hear. Listen. Many people in the world today, they only want to hear what they want to hear. But what God is doing in the church is to say what you need to hear. There's a big difference with what I want to hear and what I need to hear. What we need to hear may be hurtful, but God understands that if you endure the pain of the circumcision because of that word, it's going to be healed one day. And when you are healed because of God's dealing, powerful stuff will come out of your life. Not only that you'll be a blessing to yourself, you'll be a blessing to so many people around you. Shout amen. And so if you're confronted and God's disciplining you, endure it. It's good for you. If somebody's saying to you, stop smoking, stop it. Stop getting drunk, stop it. Now, I'm not here to judge you, but I'm just saying, if God deals with you, and stop gossiping, stop it. God's discipline always leads to great fruits. And that's why the Bible also talked to us about God's pruning us. You know what? When God sees a Christian that is bearing fruits, he will prune you so that you can bear more fruits. And remember, the pruning of God is not pleasant, but painful. He will cut away little things. It's a little cut that bringeth big changes and big fruits. And God will prune you and prune me so that we can bear more fruits. And that's why I believe that everything I've been talking about up to this day is the elimination of things so that we can build a strong, healthy, and a perfect church. Here's a question I want to ask you. Do you want to be part of a strong, healthy, perfect church? Yes. And for that to happen, we all need to work together. You and I need to work together. So today, I'm going to put myself on the spotlight, as I said to you before. All I ask is that please be merciful to me, because what I'm going to talk about is the relationship between the shepherds and the sheep. But I want to start with the shepherd, because a lot of times you're sitting there thinking, Pastor is always speaking to us and about us, and who's going to talk to him about him? Well, I'll talk to myself about me. And it's okay, because I'm not afraid. I've got nothing to hide. But I believe that if I could expose myself before you, I believe that that will lead to a healthy church, because I also understand this. In a dynamic of a healthy family, if the father is not open to his kids, we're going to have some real problem at the end of the day. If moms are not open to their daughters, we're going to have some real problems at the end of the day. Some of you have been in families where there is no communication. There is no conversation between mom and dad and the children. And what happened is, because there's none of that happening at home, you start talking to people elsewhere, and they will lead you astray, because they're saying what you need to hear, what you want to hear, and not really what you need to hear. And so for us to have a healthy and a perfect church, leaders need to be put on the spot. like myself and like Tina and like Richard and like Don and like all of us that you look upon as leaders, we need to come clean and say, this is what the Bible says about what leaders should be like in the house of the Lord. Are you ready to hear this? I call this moment, let's grill the pastor. Let's roast the pastor. Let's grill, don't kill, but just grill the pastor. Amen? Are you ready for that? And after we do that, then we'll turn around and grill you. Are you ready? This is going to be awesome. I'm taking everything from the Word of God, and I'm not ashamed. I'm not ashamed to talk about these things because I know when I was preparing the message and talk and praying to God about it, I have repented through every point. And if you think that I have not repented enough, I will repent before you after this service. Honestly, I really want this church to be healthy. I really want this church to be strong. And for that to happen, leaders need to be broken. Say yes. And if you want to have a healthy family, your dad needs to be broken and a bit more transparent. Your mom, leaders must change first. For change to come to the church, it must start from the top. And here's what the Bible says. Get ready to grill the pastor. Don't kill, just grill. The word of the Lord came to me and said, son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Woe to the shepherds of Israel who only take care of themselves. Should not the shepherds take care of the flock? You eat the curds, clothe yourselves with the wool, and slaughter the choice animals, but you do not take care of the flock. You have not strengthened the weak or healed the sick or bound up the injured. You have not brought back the strays or searched for the lost. You have ruled them harshly and brutally. Oh, I don't want to be doing that. And if I have been, my gosh, I really need to change. I'm not talking about me. When we're talking about shepherds, we're talking about leaders. Not just me, shepherds, people in the church that members look to as shepherds of the flock of God. So don't just grill me, also grill Richard. Because he's there with me up there somewhere trying to lead you to the promised land. And so they scattered because there was no shepherd. And when they were scattered, they became food for wild animals. Oh. My sheep wandered all over the mountaintops, over every hill. They scattered over the whole earth, and no one searched or looked for them. If we want to have a healthy and a perfect church, number one thing that leaders must do, or shepherds of the house must do, is write this down. They must take care of the flock as their number one priority. When it comes to the church, I understand, and I should understand that even along the way, that people is God's number one priority. Church is about people. The church business is people. It's not building a building and having so much money and having nice cars, and all of these things are great. But if we have all of these things at the expense of looking after people, we miss the plot and we miss the point. The church is about people. God is about people. When he sent Jesus Christ to die, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that who shall ever believeth on him will not perish but have everlasting life. He sent him to redeem man, not just the world, but to redeem you and I, people. God is always about people, and the business of the church is about people. And leaders who lead churches must understand that in their heart, the number one priority and number one focus is people. And if you want to be a shepherd or a leader one day, understand it's not about position. It's not about prestige. It's not about the applaud and the hand claps of people. It's not about recognition. It's not about what you get for doing good. God will reward you. But the more God blesses you, the more you lay down your life for people. That's what the Bible says about us shepherds and leaders. And that's what God is all about. It's about what? People. And if you're not feeling loved here, I apologize, because I'm not the one standing at the door. Blame the guy standing at the door. We can always improve on things, but you got to understand that when it comes to church, the church's business is people. people, you, me. And I believe that God does not want you to get lost in the crowd. When we're talking about people, we're not just talking about people in general, the many of you collectively, but we're talking about individuals feeling special and unique in the midst of the crowd. And see, did you know that God, although he can, at one glance, can see billions of people, but at the same time, he can zero in on you and make you feel so good about yourself? Did you know that God is like that? That's why you should never feel like God doesn't love you. He loves you. He cares for you. And even if that is not portrayed by the church, understand that your God in heaven sees you in the midst of the billions. You are special to God. You are unique to God. Even when the devil is putting condemnation and guilt and people are saying nasty things about you, lift up your eyes, lift up your head, and understand that the God we serve is a God of love. And even though there's billions around the world, you stand unique in his presence. And that's why I keep saying, look in the mirror and admire what you see, because I know that's how he sees you. And I do that. My wife is my witness, because I know that God loves me too much. Too much. I have been rejected, neglected, dejected, ejected, all of that. But God comes in and he said, David, you're my man. Oh, I feel so good. And I don't really need somebody to say, David, you're the man. I say, I know that. What about you? It's true, because when you have this understanding, wow, the church should be emulating that image, that desire, that passion of God through leaders who see people as their number one priority. And I just want you to know, if I have to confess before you here today, I will. I'm not perfect in this area. I try my best. It's getting big, this church. To visit everyone. I get tired. I pray for you. I'm not lying. I do my best to visit everybody all the time. Some of you sheep are quite naughty. When I send you a text that I'm coming to visit, you say, no. Me, nah, me, nah. How am I supposed to show the love when I don't see you? Some of you don't even call when you're in trouble and say, Shepherd, I'm going astray. I need that big stick called the Word of God to smash my head. And some of you, when you're committing things you know you're not supposed to commit, you dodge me at the shopping malls. It's true. I'm just waving at you, trying to do my job, and you're like, ping, ping, ping. You're gone. Shall we continue? Well, roast me and roast you at the same time. Every time I send you a text, it's because I'm trying to communicate to you that you are important. And sometimes I send, some of you have received this, I send you texts with encouraging messages and even scriptures, because when I pray for you, the Lord prompt my spirit. And because it will take some time to see you, I send you a text or send you a private message. And 5 weeks later, you respond. What if that was your last day on earth? All of these things that happens behind closed doors after church is us trying to communicate to you how important you are. Don't run away. Seize the moment. Use the opportunity, because you may not understand why a leader will send a message to you, but maybe God has burdened his heart for you. That thing might save you. Otherwise, you want to be part of a church that, you know, that you don't really have anything to do with the shepherds. Every member, every sheep needs a shepherd. If you don't have a shepherd, then you're just a little meh, meh, lost somewhere in a bush, somewhere in the wilderness of life. Remember, sheep cannot survive on their own. They only survive if they go through together as a flock. I'll talk more about the sheep nature later on. It's quite funny. Number two, are you happy with this? Shepherds are supposed to ensure that the sheep are rich and healthy, spiritually, mentally, to do with knowledge, really, emotionally, physically, in relationships, marriages, finance, materially, etc., etc. Now, there's a long list there that I've given to you, but I believe the top three, I'll read it to you again, are the number one priority of a shepherd towards sheep. And that is to enrich you and make you healthy spiritually, mentally, and emotionally. If I could meet those needs with you, the top three, I believe you will take care of your physical needs, relationship, marriage, finance, materially, because we are not supposed to be helping you in everything. In case you might come to church and say, I don't like that church because they don't come and help me do my lawn. Do your own lawn. They don't come and help me wash my kids' clothes. You do that yourself. Our priority is to get the word of God in your mind. Increase you in knowledge. Somebody talk to me in this place. Well, you know, my kids' birthday, they don't turn up. Man, if we don't turn up, have fun with your kids. Do you understand what I'm saying? We don't have to do everything, but if we can meet the top three, it will help you do everything. And sometimes, some of you get married and then you get into trouble and you blame the pastor. I said, nothing to do with matching you up with that girl. That was just your own choice. We got to understand that there are things that pastors and leaders and shepherds need to do to the sheep, but there's something that the sheep must also do themselves. Number three, we are supposed to strengthen the weak. The Bible tells us that in the scripture up there. Can you see the scripture? We're supposed to strengthen the weak. Listen to me, church. If you are weak, it does not matter what area you're weak in. It is our job to come in and strengthen you. Can I also say this to you? We can't come and strengthen you if you don't want to be strengthened. If you're weak mentally, we are there to strengthen you. If you're weak spiritually, we are there to strengthen you. We cannot do our job if you don't want to be helped. But that is my job, is to strengthen you when you're weak. And that's why I have seen many of you that I've visited over the weeks and months and even the last 2 years looking good on Sunday, because there was one time I looked at you and you're looking a little bit defeated, crushed and weak. But after visiting with you, my gosh, look at you now. My gosh, you can break through anything. And when I see you become strong, I become strong. When I see you running, standing up and going for God, man, you inspire me to run with you and to be able to help other people become strong also. Somebody say amen. The house of God is a house of power. If you are weak here today, God says, I have given you the spirit of power, love, and sound mind. That's why we should not come into the house of God and feel like we're going to go home weak. No, in the presence of God, you're supposed to be strong, because our God is powerful. He's all powerful, all knowing. He is omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent. I'll leave the rest to you. Are you hearing what I'm saying here today? Number three, number four, heal the sick. Our job as leaders, as shepherds, is to heal the sick. And again, we're talking about spiritual sickness, mental sickness, emotional sickness, relationship sickness, and even physical sickness. And if you're here today and you're saying, Pastor, I need healing. Yeah, you're in the right place. And if you need healing and you tried the doctors and you tried money and you tried wealth and you tried everything, but that issue is still persisting with you, call on us, because that's what we're here for, is to help you heal the sick. And it's not just physical sickness. There are all kinds of sickness in people's lives, but you must understand that we are there for you. We make ourselves available. I make myself available, but I do believe that people need to just call us. I sometimes do not like texting you and making appointments with you, because I don't know whether you really want to see me or not. But how I pray one day that God will give you the strength and the courage to be able to say, I'm sick and I need help. It's our job is to help you heal the sick, whatever it is in your life. Number five, bound up the injured. Many of you sitting here were injured for so many things in the past. Many of you sitting here are injured mentally. Many of you are injured emotionally from past relationship. Many of you are injured from all kinds of things that happened in the past. When you come to the house of God and when you're part of a church, I want you to understand that part of the deal is that you must be bound up in these areas. Whatever it is that have injured you, because injury leaves scars in people's lives. And there are many scars in this house, but we've got to open up and say, listen, I've got this deep scar emotionally. I've got this deep scar spiritually. I've got this deep scar. I can't talk to anybody. I need help. Listen, this is why you come to church for. Whatever it is that have wounded you, open up. And that is my job. As I read through this, I said, God, help me do my job properly. Help me do it better than what I used to do before, because I don't want to stand before God and he's looking at me and said, David, look behind you. And I look, all these wounded sheep all behind me. And he said, why are they still wounded, David? You see, and I don't want to stand before God, judge for the things that I should have done but didn't do. But I want you to understand that when you come to church, we, the shepherds and the leaders of the church, are supposed to help you with your injury. Number six, I think it is. I've lost count, but it's all up there. Is to bring back the strays. Some of you here have come to God, went away on a little holiday, and you're back again. And some of your friends have come to Jesus, strong at church, on fire, but they're out there again. They've gone astray. It's part of our job collectively as leaders and shepherds is for us to reach out and bring back the strays. Amen? And if you know of anybody, church, listen to me. If you know of any of your friends and loved ones that used to be on fire for Jesus but no longer in Christ, call us. It's our job to reach out and to bring them back in. That's what God is saying to the shepherds of the house of Israel. Are you bringing back the strays or are they going and you're not reaching out to them? That's why, as I said to you earlier, we've been sending out messages, praying for you, because we know that God wants you to come to him and be part of the penfold and stay put. But don't go out again, because there are vicious wolves out there waiting for you to come away from the flock so that they can devour you. The devil roam around like a roaring lion looking for somebody to devour. And if you move away from the flock, move away from the church, you become an easy target. That's why you cannot stray or go astray and stay going astray. Come back to us. Come back to the church. Come back to the shepherds, because they can only do their job for you if you're within the flock. Say amen. Are you still enjoying this? And the last one is, the Bible tells us, search for the lost. It is our job as pastors and leaders to look for the lost. And we're not talking about those of you that were found but now gone out again. The Bible is talking about friends and families of yours that don't know God yet. They are lost without Jesus. And it's our job as shepherds and leaders and pastors to go out and reach out to the lost and bring them back into the house. Can I say this to you? Please don't let us go out and bring the lost and come back here and you're lost again. It's just too much work. We go out and bring all of Hickey's friends. They all come to church, all excited. And we look around for Hickey. He's gone out again. I said, can you just make our job easy, Hickey? Stay put. I'm just using Hickey as an example, but I know Hickey's not lost. He's healed. His injury are all bound up. He's emotionally stable. Hickey is here to stay. Hey, Hickey. Oh, is he here or is he gone already? Please don't let us go out there and bring Connie's friends. And we come back here and Connie's not here anymore. It's a great joy when your friends and your loved ones who were once lost but now found, blind but now can see, dead but now have life. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one gets to the Father except through me. There is only one way to bring the lost back, and that is to preach Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life. I tell you, if you have found Jesus, stay put. But don't create more work. Amen. And all the young ones here, there, Tina, congratulate you for the graduation, year 12. Young man, I ask you to stay strong in God. I mean, did you watch what's happening with what happens all the time and down the Gold Coast? What do they call it? The schoolies. They become foolies. Climbing from one room to the next, getting drunk like monkeys. You don't want to be like that. The world is encouraging a standard of destruction, but God is raising a standard of righteousness, power, and strength. And he's looking for young men and women that will say, that's me. I'm not going to compromise. I'm going to stand for Jesus. So we've got to understand, if you know people who are lost, call us or let's work with us. We'd like to also work with you. And John 10, 13, 11 to 13, I'm almost done. Are you enjoying this? Are you sure? We got to talk about this, because I tell you this, to have a healthy, perfect church, you got to understand the responsibility of shepherds over your lives and also the loved ones that you have and friends that God will bring to him through you. And this is what John 10, 11, 13 says, I'm the good shepherd, Jesus said. The good shepherd lay down his life for the sheep. I love that. I want to be part of a church where the pastor would lay down his life for me. I don't want to be part of a church where I could call the pastor my dad and he has no idea who I am. Did you know that many churches, and I've heard that many Christians, say, one guy, and let me say this too, because it's quite comical and funny and foolish at the same time. I said, hey, do you have a spiritual father or a pastor? He said, yeah. I have a spiritual mother. I said, yeah, who is it? Joyce Meyer. And I said, okay. Does she know you? No, she doesn't. But she's my spiritual mother. I said, you know what? You're fooling yourself. Joyce Meyer, I have no idea who you are. She lives in America. You live here in Australia. Get to a local church and connect to a pastor, you little monkey. Shepherds needs to know you. Not through Facebook. Not through assumption. They need to know your first name, where you live. The church has just gone into a direction that is absolutely foolish in my understanding. The assumption is so strong in the church that it's moving away from truth versus assumption. Got to get back to the truth. And you know what? Jesus said, I'm the good shepherd. The shepherd laid down his life for the sheep. And if you're saying, Pastor David, you're my pastor, I don't even know you. I don't even see you at church. When I send a text to come and see you, you refuse for me to come and see you. How can I lay down my life for you when I don't even know you? I don't have a relationship with you. And you go to the hospital and say, oh, I wish my pastor would lay down his life for me right now. Pray for me. I have no idea where you are, who you are, what you are. You're just fooling yourself. People ask you, what church you go to? Breakthrough. Oh, yeah? Yeah. I go there once a year. That's not membership. I don't know what you call that. I know my kid's name. Kizzy, yeah, that's your first name, right? I know my second child's name. I know my kids. I know the room they sleep in. I know the school they go to. I know their ages, I hope. I still remember. I know something about my kids. God wants shepherds to know the sheep so that we can lay down our lives for you. And please don't accuse us of something we're not doing only because we just didn't know. But you can help us know that, yes? The hired man is not the shepherd who owns the sheep. When he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. It's like this man is like, you know what? The devil is attacking me, but Joyce Meyer is too busy. She's not praying for me because she does not know you. A
Call Choice Maya. I'm under attack. Call whoever you call spiritual father, shepherd, leader. Some sheep are just... Anyway, man. Turn around to somebody and say, stop being silly and walk wisely. And are you enjoying this? Are you enjoying this? You want to have a healthy church? You want to have a healthy church? Can we work on this thing, please? Stop assuming. Get to knowledge and understanding. Get to real connection. Because when the wolf comes, you should be able to say, Pastor, and the pastor say, yes, a wolf is scratching at the door. Don't worry. You tell the wolf to just keep that claws off you, because I'll be praying for you right now. You know, people have rang me and Tina about issues they're going through. We drop everything and we pray. You know why? Because we know them. They know us. They're part of us. And some people have rang me up from other cities. I don't even know them. They saw me on Facebook and say, Pastor, I'm in trouble. Hey, Pastor, what do I do? What do I do? I said, who is your pastor? Don't call me. Call him. True. It would be the same case as Kesey come home and said, Daddy, Daddy, somebody punched me at school. And I said, go to the father next door and talk to him about who punched you at school. Let's get real with this thing called church. Are you a sheep? Meh. Connect to the shepherd so they can do their job. The wolf then attacks the flock and scatters. The man runs away because he's a hired man and cares nothing for the sheep. And Jesus said, shepherds will lay down their lives for the sheep. And the last one, they will protect and defend the sheep. Can you give me 5 minutes just to talk about you? Can I roast you for 5 minutes? Is that okay? Let's look at the sheep now. And let's just read this and then we go home. This is good. Get ready for this. Hey? This is called sheep to sheep. Ezekiel 34, 17 to 24. You got to see this. Is it up there? Anyway, I'll read it to you. Ezekiel 34, 17 to 24. As for you, my flock, this is what the sovereign Lord says. I will judge between one sheep and another, and between the rams and the goats. Can I also say this to you right now? That in the church, there are three kinds of Christians. The sheep, the rams, and the goats. And in this room right here, we have the sheep who are very gullible, easily led. They're just gentle. You know, they'll be led to be slaughtered and they will say nothing because that's what they are. And some of you are like that, your personality like a sheep, like, yeah, whatever, Pastor, we just, and then we have in the church the rams, and they live up to their name, they just ram into anything. They are the wild one. They are the wild bunch. You know, the pastor said, come this way. Pastor said, that way. They're stubborn. They're just full of something else. And then you have the goat, which is, you know, quite wise and intelligent animal. They may not look like sheepishly, or they may not look like the rams, but my gosh, they're more dangerous than the other two because they can outthink you. You can talk to them about things and they sit there smiling at you, but in here, they already figure you out and already devise a plan on how to kill you. There are some Christians who are sheep, easily led. Some are just rams. They just want to ram into anything. Even the things you should not be running into, you still run into. God said, don't run into that. Boom. And then you come to church and say, Pastor, heal my head. No, we should give you the fivefold ministry for that one. And then you have the goats who are just, man, they're just smart, like Daniel Gavitz. Very smart. He doesn't say much. He smiles at you. But I tell you this, that guy's already figured you out. He's like, Amen. And that's why God says there are these kinds of people in the church. And it talks about the people's different personalities, their natures, their attitudes, their abilities, their strength. It's good to be part of a church where everybody's themselves. I don't want to clone you. You don't want to be cloned. You got to be yourself. But at least submit to God and the shepherds. If you are a ram, stop ramming into me. Come with me. If you're a goat, be a goat and let's go together. And if you're a sheep, be a sheep and let's go together. Don't fight each other. Don't fight the shepherds. Let's all go together. Somebody shout amen in the house. Because there's some rams in this house. I have met you. Oh, you are dangerous. I talk to you over coffee and you're smiling at me. I walk away and I just know in my spirit you did not accept anything I said. But you're smart. You're buying my coffee. You sit there throughout the whole hour of our counseling and our conversation and act like you're really listening. You don't. And there's some of you, I've met you, I've talked with you, and I walk away and I'm like, oh my gosh, it went right in here, then dropped in here, went right, and he is figuring me out already and making something of me that is not even right or true. You're not here today. Those people are not at church today. So you're safe. They might come back to church next Sunday. Be yourself. But let's move together. Amen. And let's. This is. I'm almost done here. Are you enjoying this? This is what I call roast the sheep. It is not enough for you. What's this? This is funny. It is not enough for you to feed on the good pastures. Must you also trample on the rest of the pasture with your feet? There are some sheep, some Christians, some members in this church. They are here enjoying God's green pasture. And while they're having fun, they are trampling on it so the others don't enjoy it. Is it not enough for you to drink clear water? Must you also muddy the rest of the water? Must my flock feed on what you trampled and drink on what you muddied with your feet? Oh my gosh. I have come. Not really. I have heard and I have met people who have talked to me about how other members have hurt them in this church. How other members have said things about them that hurt them, that they're staying back, trying to figure out whether they're going to come back to church or not. Why somebody muddied the water. Somebody trembled on the pasture. There are some wild sheep in there. You are not only receiving, but you are muddying the thing for everybody else. Stumbling people, hurting people, whether consciously or not, but you are hurting people. We should not do that. You want to have a strong, healthy, perfect church? Come on, sheep. We got to stop muddying the water. Stop trembling on the pastures. Eat and make way. This is how you should eat. I got to try that again. It's going to be better than that. And then you look around. Make way for others. Make way for others. But don't do this. What is that? What is that? We want to have a healthy family. Build it together. Don't kill each other. Don't trample on the food. Don't muddy the water. It's all going quiet now. Roast the sheep. Therefore, this is what the Sovereign Lord says to say to them. See, I myself will judge between the fat and the lean. We have some fat ones in this place. And I'm not talking about fat physically because we are all guilty of that. We've got some honky, beefy sheep in here. I'm talking about fat spiritually. But you know what it is?
If God is saying there's some fat sheep in the church, it speaks of laziness and procrastination and lack of obedience. You're just eating, eating, and sleeping every day. That's why you're fat. Just in the natural, when you don't exercise what you put in, you'll be fat. But there's some lean one who eat, but then they go out and exercise like, you know, yours truly, myself. Oh, no? Okay. But sheep, if you're fat, that may not be a good sign that you are healthy. It could be a sign that you are full of disobedience and lazy and not doing what you're supposed to be doing. And also the lean one. And sometimes I'm thinking about the lean sheep and they're saying, you know what, because we obey the Lord and pastor, we eat and we go out and exercise. I think some of them are lean because the rams just don't make way for them. They're just eating outside the bowl. I don't know what makes you lean, but hey, the Bible tells us we've got to treat each other with love and honor and respect. Amen. And let me finish by saying this. See, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep, because you have shoved with flank and shoulder and butting all the weak sheep with your horns until you have driven them all away. Can I ask this church, if you want to build a healthy church, please make way for others and don't deliberately do things to drive them away and can never even give a care if they don't come back. It is a wicked thing for us to stumble others in the house of God and don't even care if they don't come back. The Bible tells us that those who stumble people like that, it's better that a millstone be tied around your neck and throw you into the ocean. Because we are not supposed to do that to other people in the house. If you know that your life or your words, your actions, or conduct have caused somebody to go away from God and they're still away from God, look for that person and bring them back straight away. Because that will go against your record in heaven. It's true. I will judge between one sheep and another. I will place them over one shepherd, my servant, David Vaca. I'm just kidding. It's just David in the Bible. You're looking very serious at me like this guy. And he will tend them. I mean, that's my hope. I want to be a great shepherd. He will tend them and be their shepherd. I, the Lord, will be their God. And my servant David will be a prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken. Can I ask you here today? Please, don't tremble on the food and muddy the water. And please don't be a fat sheep by just consuming and not producing, spectating and not participating, high maintenance and no impact. Please don't do that. And don't be a lean sheep because you're just not eating. Get inside and eat. But be lean because you are receiving and exercising what God has given to you. My last point is this summary. We, the shepherds, must be faithful to our roles and responsibility for the sheep. And I'm speaking to myself and Richard and many leaders here. We must love, respect, honor, and help one another in God, especially the sheep. Shepherds and sheep, leaders and members, we must work together diligently, sacrificially, passionately to build a strong and a healthy church, not only for us, but for those that God will bring along the way. Let us arise and build breakthrough church according to God's perfect and original intention. In closing, read the book of Acts. You know what happened? When the church was healthy, God bring people to a healthy church. We may not even have to go out and tell them to come. When people hear about this breakthrough church, they love each other. The shepherds are looking after the sheep. The sheep are looking after one another. They are working together to build a strong and a stable and a perfect church. When the news of this church being healthy travels around the community, everybody will talk about us. Everybody will hear about us. Everybody want to know about us. Everybody want to come and see. What makes this church awesome? It's because inside the house is what? Healthy. And God will bring people. You just watch and see. Amen. Let's pray.